This year, 2012, also marks the 300th anniversary of the birth of Frederick II, or Frederick the Great, as he's known. And as part of that, I recently actually saw what you have just described as the kind of change that has happened here. And if you actually do this consciously and look at how what kind of leaps have been made, I mean, in Germany as well as in the United States, going from the 18th to the 20th century, it shouldn't actually be so hard to imagine a world that is entirely different again from today's. For instance, in talking about a moon or a Mars program. Now, I want to ask a question that has reached us, I have no idea how many times, but many, many times, which basically is of the same shape wherever you meet it. People will ask, well, we do have enough problems down here, so why do we have to go to moon? Why do we have to go to Mars? And in that same light, I might ask as the counterpoint to that question, you already indicated something about the oligarchical nature of the green movement. So maybe you can combine that a little bit, because it appears from that perspective of a very fascinating and inspiring development of Germany, the green tendency seems to represent everything that is opposite to that. So maybe you can address that as well.
Well, I think this idea of conservation, that you have to save energy, you have to conserve limited resources, that belongs to a universe which is not the real universe, but it has been brainwashed. I remember because we had ideas about the development of Africa and other parts of the world already at the beginning of the 70s. As a matter of fact, that was why I joined Mr. LaRouche, who was not my husband at that time, but why I joined his movement, because I came back from a trip which had shortly led me also to Africa and China and some Asian countries. And I came back from this trip with the absolute commitment that the condition of the, especially the developing sector, was such that it could not remain, because you know, there are poverty, unnecessary, terrible condition of life required a development program, which, you know, Mr. LaRouche was proposing already at that time. And I thought that is it. That's what I want to devote my life to. So therefore, I had already an idea how to develop Africa at the beginning of the 70s. And therefore, when the oligarchy decided to go for a complete paradigm shift with the absolute intentional idea to eliminate cultural optimism, to eliminate the ideas associated with the Apollo program of John F. Kennedy, for example, where people were absolutely convinced that you can solve any problem with science and technology, where if you would ask young people, you know, what do you want to become when you grow up, they would say, I want to become an astronomer, I want to go, you know, I want to fly my dog in space like Laika. They would have all kinds of optimistic ideas. they wanted to eradicate that and impose cultural pessimism. And that was why you had, at the beginning of the 70s, from MIT, Forrester, and Meadows, why you had the Club of Rome all of a sudden saying limits to growth. Until now, maybe the world developed, but now we have reached this equilibrium, and now in a closed system we have to deal with you know, limited resources and save, conserve nature and all of these things. Now that obviously is a complete lie, and Meadows and Forrester later admitted that they had pre-programmed their computer model with the end result being there in the beginning and then reprogramming in such a way that that result was there, and that they had committed a complete intellectual fraud by leaving out the role of science and technology to determine what is a resource. Now, if you do that, then naturally it's a complete fraud, because you know, you can take a piece of stone And if you are in the Stone Age, you can take that stone and hit your neighbor and kill him, or you can take the stone and say, oh, this stone has the following interesting minerals, ores, and I can use it for the following productions if I treat it in a following way. And naturally, you know, what a resource is completely determined by the level of technology with which you treat this. For example, with modern thermonuclear fusion power, you can basically take garbage and turn it back into new isotopes for production, for all kinds of things. So in other words, once you make a new leap, you reach new resources. And Meadows and Forrester completely, you know, left that out, committing a fraud. And at that time, the Club of Rome put out this book and similar studies, millions of dollars in all languages. Simultaneously, they threw this garbage all over the planet. And naturally, you know, I mean, I was at the beginning of this transformation because I went to the UN Population Conference in 1974 with a clear plan for the development of Africa. And, you know, at that point, there was Rockefeller III, who was chairing the NGO part of the conference, and he laid out a completely disgusting proposal of sustainable development, of renewable resources, that population growth is the biggest threat to civilization. And at that time, nobody believed him. As a matter of fact, all the NGOs and the left groups which were there, they said, ah, population growth, that is a Rockefeller baby. It's a myth invented by the Rockefeller Foundation for their own interest, because they were not brainwashed yet at that time. Now, since that, 74, you almost have 35 years or 37 years have passed. And if you think about all the different scare stories about anthropogenic climate change, now, people believe that. You know, the reality is that the CO2 emission, which comes from human productivity, is so negligible that you could have a little fly sitting on an elephant scratching the elephant and the elephant wouldn't even notice. The real changes in the climate obviously come from the cyclical developments of our galaxy, of sun activities, which, you know, a year ago when we started our weather reports, you know, people said, ah, this is ridiculous, you know, galactic weather, sun influencing the weather. They completely poo-pooed it. In the meantime, Bild-Zeitung says new storms on the sun affecting our weather. So, you know, you can see how in 1 year, our consistent pushing a certain idea has become a normal idea, you know, which shows you the power of ideas if these ideas are right, and if these ideas intersect a moment of crisis. Now, I want to take back this greenie problem, because the greenie problem today, and you have unfortunately a complete greenization of the brains of all parties in Germany. It's not just the Green Party, but it's all parties. All parties have become green. Now, that is why the Büso is so absolutely crucial, because we are not, and we have never made a compromise with that. Among other things, because we understand what is the real physical universe and why this notion of Gaia is absurd. Prince Philip at one point said that, he said that at a public conference, that we have to go back to the pre-Christian mythologies of Gaia and other cyclical ideas, because only these mythologies allow for the population reduction which are desirable, while Christianity does not. So it's clear what the intention is behind. And, you know, when I came across this green problem for the first time, I started to look at where it comes from. And there is a very interesting book by from the Siemens Foundation called Conservative Revolution, which people should read because it's a real interesting story, which traces back correctly the idea of conservation of nature to an oligarchical counter-deployment against the so-called ideas of 1789, meaning on the one side naturally the ideas of the French Revolution, but also meaning the ideas of the American Revolution, because 1789 was not only the crucial year for France, but it was also the year where George Washington moved into the White House for the first time. And at that time, the entire oligarchy of Europe and the United States decided to try to roll back the principles of the American Revolution, which had been established, you know, in the War of Independence, and which are expressed in the American Constitution and in the Declaration of Independence, namely that every human being has the right for life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness, which means a fulfilled life. That's what pursuit of happiness really means. So they decided to have this idea of the conservative revolution, conserve the values of the feudal society before these changes, and basically go back to these cultural pessimistic ideas of the eternal return of the same, which was then later pushed by Nietzsche and which directly led to the ideology of the Nazis. Now, if you trace back these conservative revolution movements, of which there were 400, they lived on in the youth movement before World War I, the glorification of nature. They lived through the First World War, expressed by such people as Ernst Jünger, who is a representative of the continuation of this tradition. And, you know, it was exactly going back to these ideas, which after all also flourished in the Third Reich. And that is really what it is. It is this idea of an oligarchical order, of limited resources, of conservation of energy, of low energy flux densities, and low population. And, you know, if you ask a greenie, are you for development aid, you have a very high chance that he says, oh no, if we give development aid to the third world, it just means they multiply more. I mean, that's an answer I have gotten repeatedly, and it just shows you the cynicism of these people. And it does not surprise me at all that the greenies are now instrumental, together with Golos, together with the same apparatus of George Soros, in the attempt to destabilize Putin in the coming election, as they had demonstrated in their recent event in the Bundestag. So they're part and piece of parcel of the oligarchical system. They are what the machine troopers, Maschinenstürmer were at a certain point. And, you know, it happens to be that in Germany they also became the party of the best earning, you know, the people being rich, profiting from this trend. We have, you know, demonstrated and documented that the hedge funds like greenies. The reason is that there is now a big profit in CO2 emission trade, in investment in solar parks, in wind energy. And I can only say this is the wrong way for Germany to go. And already now, it was mentioned at the recent DIHK conference that already 20% of the German Mittelstand have either left Germany or are planning to do so, because the combination of energy insecurity, which is threatening some industries who cannot take any vacillation whatsoever, and the increase of energy prices simply mean that Germany as a location for industry is no longer attractive. So if Germany wants to survive as an industrial and scientific power, let's get rid of the greenies.